I'd like to reserve 5 minutes if I could.
Okay, well, we'll try.
I want to focus, to start off here, on what this case is really about in practical terms. San Francisco has very stringent rent control laws, which means that tenants have essentially unilateral ability to decide how long they're going to stay in a rental unit. It could be 30 years, could be in perpetuity. And landlords have, with very few exceptions, no ability to change that. The one avenue that's available to them is their ability to request that a tenant voluntarily leave a unit and to offer to pay them to do so. This ordinance is a means of trying to clamp down and chill landlords' ability to exercise their speech in that manner. I'll give you an example. You could have a building with a middle-aged couple. They own 4 units, live in one of them.
Let me ask you this, Mr. Scudero. Is it your point that before the landlord can ask the tenant whether he would consider moving out for a consideration, the form, the disclosure form, has to be delivered to the tenant?
No, Your Honor, it's more than that even. Yes, it does need to be delivered first, but it also then...
No, no, delivered before he... I'm not talking about... The term is negotiation. Does negotiation include inquiry as to whether the tenant is interested in negotiating?
Yes, Your Honor, I believe it does. The terms of the ordinance are very broad in their definition of buyout negotiations.
So what it boils down to then, if you're correct, is that the landlord can never ask the tenant, are you interested in moving out? It's only the tenant who can initiate the conversation.
I think in a very narrow set of circumstances, the landlord could walk up and say, here's this form, will you sign it so that we can discuss the possibility of a buyout? But having already provided the form, and they have to get the signature right then and there before any discussion.
Well, he has to provide the form, but where is it in the regulations that he has to have the form signed before he can ask whether the tenant is interested in negotiating?
Well, I think, Your Honor, given the terms of the ordinance itself, the plain language, it says that prior to commencing buyout negotiations for a rental unit, the landlord has to provide the written disclosure, and it has to include a space for that tenant to sign a date, basically confirming.
So he has to give them the disclosure form, step one, and say, at that point, maybe you're interested in moving out. But he doesn't have to get the signature on the form then before he can start discussing negotiation, does he?
I believe he does, Your Honor.
Where in the ordinance is it required that the tenant sign the blank form that he has to be handed by the landlord before the landlord can discuss or negotiate move out?
Well, Your Honor, in fact, the position of the city and the district court in this case is that that's not required. And
that's right. And the reason it's not the position is because it's not required.
Well, respectfully, I disagree, because the ordinance says prior to commencing buyout negotiations, they're required to provide it and get the tenant's signature.
No, does it say that they have to get a signed signature before negotiation, or you have to deliver the form before negotiation?
Well, you have to deliver the form with
that's
the,
right.
With the space for the tenant's signature.
With the space, and the tenant can say, I don't have my glasses, I don't know where the space is, but let's discuss the negotiation. That'd be all right, wouldn't it?
Your Honor, I think...
I'm talking about the text of the ordinance.
Yes.
We have to be guided by the text. Now, maybe as a practical matter, your argument is the landlord doesn't know whether the tenant wants to discuss or can't have any proof that the tenant has received the form until the tenant signs it. But that's not what the text of the statute says, right?
Well, Your Honor, I'm not sure I agree with that reading, but I do want to say that...
Why don't you agree with that reading? Where in the text of the statute does it say the form must be signed before negotiations take place?
I think, Your Honor, that if I'm a landlord and I read this form,
You're sort of avoiding the question. Isn't the answer that a text doesn't require the signature?
It says prior to commencing buyout negotiations, they have to provide the form with the line for the signature.
With the line for the signature. But there's nowhere does it say that the tenant has to sign the form before the negotiations start. Can we agree on that and go to some other point?
I'm happy to go on because, Your Honor, quite frankly, I don't know that it matters, strictly speaking. You mentioned as a practical effect, it's the same result, and I believe that it is. If I'm a landlord and I hand over the form and the tenant doesn't sign it immediately, I'm not going to take my chances of committing a violation of the ordinance in the hopes that somewhere down the line I might get them to make sure that my speech is okay after the fact.
And what's the purpose of PDR 80, which is the declaration of the landlord that attests to the delivery of the notice and contains a sworn declaration that he did provide the notice to the tenant?
Well, I think it's duplicative. I think it makes all of this requirement that the tenant pretty much sign the form sort of gratuitous. But the fact is that the failure to obtain that signature subjects the landlord to potential penalties, regardless of whether he has also
filed. Doesn't this form issued by the Rent Stabilization and Arbitration Board contemplate a tenant who, for whatever reason, just doesn't sign the acknowledgement of the number? Do you see the number?
I don't think so, Your Honor, because
doesn't this protect the landlord from a subsequent claim that I didn't know, he never gave me the form, and he files it with the board, and it's like a process server, leaving it at leaving the complaint at your feet. All he has to do is file an affidavit saying I served him in the manner prescribed by law, and that's effective notice, is it not?
Well, no, I don't believe it is.
Then what's the purpose of the form?
That I'm afraid you'll have to ask the city, but
I'll ask the city that question. The answer is pretty obvious.
The ordinance requires both. It requires that you serve that form with the rent board, of course, and it also requires that you get a signed form from the tenant, and the failure to do either one subjects the landlord.
Your point is to any language that in the ordinance that says you cannot even discuss the subject of buyout negotiations unless the tenant signs.
Well, Your Honor, as I said, I think I disagree. I believe that the language of the ordinance does say that. But even if it doesn't,
you don't have any words that you can
use. Well, I think if you read the section 37.9E sub D, that is fairly clear. And I don't think that the city's forms do anything to dispel the notion that it needs to be provided and signed in advance.
And it makes that particular form that I directed you to kind of superfluous.
Well, I agree that it's superfluous, Your Honor. We've argued, I think, in our papers that there's really no need for this requirement to get a tenant signature as a constitutional matter. It's overkill because you already have a mechanism for ensuring that the landlords are providing notices. But the fact is that the ordinance does require it, whether we think it's a good idea or not.
Well, it would be up to the defense to the landlord if he got cited for this and say, well, the district court found that you don't require a signature, and their lawyer admitted it as a judicial admission. That pretty much takes care of the problem, does it?
I don't believe it does. And the reason I don't believe it does is that what the city and the district court have said is that the ordinance allows the landlord to take their chances. So a landlord can say, okay, here's the form, you don't need to sign it, let's talk. But then they take their chance that down the road, they're not going to get that signature for whatever reason, and then they're on the hook. And so then they're basically forced to take their chance and roll the dice that if they don't get that signature right up front, they may be subject to potential litigation and penalties down the road. Now, in some cases, it may be that they can kind of clean up the mess, if you will, by getting that signature after the fact, but there's no guarantee. And so it's that fact that really creates the chilling effect. Why would a landlord take the chance of entering buyout negotiations when they haven't been able to obtain a signature from a tenant? It has a chilling effect on any realistic idea that they're going to go ahead and open buyout negotiations with these tenants when they can't get that signature and have the confidence that those negotiations are not going to violate the ordinance.
Doesn't the same risk exist in civil litigation if the defendant refuses to acknowledge receipt of the summons and complaint?
I'm not sure that it necessarily does because the rules of procedure allow for multiple different ways of confirming delivery. And I understand.
Isn't this a way of confirming delivery? They've created a form that the landlord signs and files with the board attesting to the delivery of the notice.
And if the ordinance allowed penalties for not providing the notice, if that were the violation, then that I could understand that point. But what it does is it provides a penalties for not having and keeping the signed form from the tenant. In other words, it penalizes independently each of
you say the signed form, and I assume we're all arguing about D10 in the ordinance.
Yes.
That the form shall include under 10, quote, a space for each tenant to sign and write the date the landlord provided the tenant with the disclosure, end quote.
Well, okay, if I could go on just a further, it continues, the landlord shall retain a copy of the signed disclosure form for 5 years, along with the record of the deed the landlord provided the disclosure. So if the landlord doesn't have that signed form, they're subject to penalties regardless of whether they separately file.
If you can prove that the tenant wouldn't sign it but did want to negotiate.
Well, there's no defense for that in the plain text of the ordinance.
Well, not the contemporaneously filed declaration of service.
Again, Your Honor, the ordinance itself doesn't say you shall be liable because you didn't provide notice. It says you shall be liable because you did not get and keep a form signed by the tenant. And yes, you would be liable also for not filing with the rent board, but that's a separate requirement. It's not a substitute.
But why doesn't the filing with the rent board protect the landlord from a subsequent claim by the tenant that he talked to me about buyouts without providing me with notice?
Well, because that's not what the actual offense would have been. It's not that just that you talked about it. It's that the violation is that you did not get and keep the signed form. It's not just that you talked to them without the sign, getting the signature. It's also that you don't have the form and you haven't maintained it.
The obligation to sign is each tenant must sign.
Correct.
And if the tenant doesn't sign, then the landlord doesn't have to keep the form.
Well, but then they also can't discuss buyout negotiations.
If he's got a videotape of handing the form to the tenant, he can prove that he did. What you're saying is that there has to be a signature by the tenant. That's the only way of showing that the form was delivered. That's not so.
That's actually, respectfully, that's not what I'm saying. I'm saying that whether or not you provided it, if you don't have the signature, that independently is a violation of the ordinance.
No, only if the tenant signed it and you don't keep it. But if the tenant refuses to sign it, you can't very well force it. Landlord to keep a signed form which wasn't signed by the tenant, can you?
Well, I understand that, but then, of course, you can't have buyout negotiations and enter into an agreement because that buyout negotiation, that agreement, would subject you to liability for not having a signed form.
No, because you have your bishop standing there watching you hand the form to the tenant.
Yes.
He's a witness, and then he will testify, and he's on videotape. You don't need
Your Honor, far be it for me to question the word of the bishop, of course. But frankly, the ordinance doesn't say if you have a bishop who's willing to testify.
No, it says you have to deliver the form.
It also says you need to obtain and keep a signed copy.
If it's signed, then the duty is on the tenant to sign it.
But if you don't.
Next, let's go to some other issue of the case.
How about the 10-year restriction? That one, I'm not sure I understand it. Does it mean that if two or more tenants or any disabled or senior citizen is the subject of a buyout, that the apartment building is now frozen for 10 years?
That's exactly what it means. They do not have the option of proceeding through the discretionary request process for obtaining a condominium conversion permit.
And how is that an unconstitutional taking if it applies prospectively?
Well, I think we've argued, Your Honor, that not that a taking per se, but that it's an arbitrary penalty for engaging in legal contract rights. Quite frankly, that requirement or that penalty, if you will, has no real logical nexus to what we're talking about here, which is a bill designed to protect tenants from harassment. The only people who are going to be penalized by this are the people who actually jumped through all the hoops and followed all the rules that were meant to protect those tenants. And the tenant still, after all of that, said, this is a good deal for me, I'm going to go ahead. And so we're penalizing the good guys who actually did what they were supposed to do. So it serves no purpose in terms of harassment. And in terms of maintaining affordable housing, yet there's no reason to single out these people who have paid for a buyout and treat them somehow differently from everybody else who has housing within the city simply because they've exercised these contract rights. In terms of affordability, clearly if the tenant thought they couldn't find some affordable alternative, they wouldn't take the deal. And now you've opened up a unit that someone else could go ahead and rent instead. So it just, there's no logical nexus whatsoever between that penalty, which is clearly designed, I mean, on the face of the ordinance, is designed to discourage buyout negotiations. There's no logical connection between that penalty and any of the purposes identified for this ordinance. It's simply
not saying that landlords are a protected class.
I am not saying
that. You're saying is there's no rational, legitimate purpose to eliminating the ability of the landlord to condominionize because he's exercises his power to negotiate a buyout.
That's exactly correct.
But isn't that a political matter?
Well, it's not, Your Honor. Under the cases that we've cited, the government has to act in a rational manner. I understand that the standard is essentially...
Well, the rationale is to make the buyout more difficult. They want to protect tenants against even a negotiated buyout by saying to the landlord, if you do that and it's legal, you're not going to be able to condominionize for the next 10 years. So it's an impediment to the exercise of property rights, no question.
It's essentially a ban on, or effectively
a ban on condominiums.
Well, but only on a certain category of condominiums. All the other landlords in the city still have the same options. It's only the ones who enter into a bilateral negotiated agreement, voluntary agreement.
And you agree that the whole purpose of that is just intimidate landlords from using their buyout negotiations.
I absolutely agree with that.
And what's wrong with that?
Well, Your Honor, I don't think that there's any rational public policy justification for it.
Well, the public policy is to intimidate landlords so they won't get rid of tenants. They want to protect the tenants are a politically protected class.
Well,
in San Francisco.
Well, of course, in San Francisco.
Let me ask you something else. I'm concerned with the idea that the declarations would show the price the landlord paid must be filed. So it shows what the landlord was willing to pay for a buyout to the world. Right? You claim that information is private, and this the California Constitution protects that from disclosure. And you say that's undoubtedly so. Pardon me to say that I have a doubt, and I want to know what basis you say that it's undoubtedly so that this private pricing information, which I consider very valuable from the point of view of the landlord, because other tenants will know what he's willing to pay, and they know the inside price, right? What is the authority for saying that that's a violation of privacy?
Well, Your Honor, I think that the cases we cited, the H&M Associates and the Molsky case, both stand for the proposition that private business dealings, private business records.
Let me ask you about H&M Associates. Is that a situation where pricing information was made public?
It was not specifically pricing information.
The general language, the improper use of information properly obtained for a specific purpose, for example, the use of it for another purpose or the disclosure, it doesn't have a factual resemblance in this case, does it?
Well, it's still private financial information of the landlord.
What financial information was involved in H&M Associates?
The accusation there was that the landlord had not paid his public water bill in a timely fashion. And that the city manager, who it was a city water system, the city manager went out and broadcast that to the world, and I believe said that they were going to initiate some sort of penalty phase, and it drove down the value of the property when they went after it. And so it wasn't that having the information, the government having the information was improper in that case. It was that they then turned around and made it public to everybody else. And that's our contention here. It's one thing to require the filing of this information with the government agency and regulatory body, but for them then to turn around and take the entire contract with everything, it's not just the price, it's everything that could have possibly been negotiated, and put it on a website so that the entire world can track it down. We believe that that's an improper use of information that was maybe properly obtained in the
will just say one thing quickly about the signature requirement that was being discussed. My opponent says that the city is saying to landlords, take your chances. That is not what we are saying. We are saying that the landlord is not taking any chance because there is no requirement that the tenant sign the form before the landlord engage in buyout negotiations. They point to the risk that a tenant will sue the landlord for failing to comply with the obligation to retain a signed form for 5 years. But again, that's a retention obligation. It's not an obligation to obtain the signature. If you look at the form from the rent board, it's an instruction to the tenant, you must sign this form. The only obligation on the landlord is to retain it.
But there's if it's signed.
Correct. There's a maxim in the law. A person cannot take advantage of their own wrong. So a tenant obviously could not refuse to sign the form and then turn around and sue the landlord for failing to retain a signed form that the tenant refused to provide. That is just not a reasonable interpretation of the statute, and the landlord is not taking any risk by proceeding with buyout negotiations if they provided the disclosure and the tenant refuses to sign.
So, is your position then that the landlord can tender the form to the tenant, tenant refuses to sign, and then the landlord can proceed with buyout negotiations, and at that point the landlord does not have to retain the form because the tenant didn't sign it?
The landlord cannot retain a signed form if the tenant didn't sign it.
So the landlord at that point has no obligation to retain either a copy of the form that he tendered?
The landlord has to retain a record of the date the landlord provided the form.
Which is the form that I brought to Mr. Skinner's attention.
There is that form. There's nothing to prevent the landlord from making his or her own personal record of it. It could be the cell phone video. It could be a notation on the disclosure form. I gave this on this day.
Yes.
Could you answer the questions about what is the legitimate government interest in imposing a 10-year ban on condominiumizing because the landlord has properly negotiated a move-out?
What the city is doing is removing an economic incentive. We're limiting an economic incentive for a landlord to enter into that transaction in the first place. It's using its power, its police power, to regulate condominium conversions. To say, if you do a buyout in this circumstance,
your apartment is worth less.
You're not going to be able to convert it.
Right.
You're not going to be able to participate.
So what they're doing is damaging the value of the apartment.
They're not damaging the value of the apartment because there's no right to engage in a condominium conversion. It's a lottery. There's no guarantee you'll be able to anyway.
What they're doing is removing the opportunity, the opportunity to engage in condominium because a landlord has properly negotiated a move out with a tenant. And the reason they're doing that is to disincentivize landlords from using the move out. Is that correct?
Because it removes one incentive to do that transaction because in the city's judgment.
What's the legitimate governmental purpose to removing a portion of the value of a landlord's property?
The legitimate purpose is to protect the categories of tenants to which it applies. Senior tenants, seriously ill tenants, disabled tenants.
So they're taking a portion of the property value of the landlord and saying it, we're transferring that to the tenants, but it's not a taking right.
No value is being transferred to the tenants.
Yeah, because
value is being taken away from the environment.
And the incentive benefits, disincentive benefits the tenant, because the landlord is not going to use the move-out negotiation if indeed he won't be able to condominiumize or enter the lottery to condominiumize for 10 years. That's a sort of a lien on the property, isn't it?
No, it's not a lien on the property.
I mean, it's a cloud on the property.
Many things the government does encourages some financial transactions, discourages other transactions. That's the nature of government regulation, and it can do that to advance legitimate policy objectives. And it is a legitimate policy objective to protect vulnerable tenants. I mean, the three categories of tenants are people who may have special problems finding new housing.
Doesn't it also impose the 10-year ban, though, if two or more tenants who are not seniors, disabled, or negotiate a buyout?
It does, and in those cases, the reason is that that's going to have a greater impact on affordable housing. It's not just a one-off.
So it's not protecting other vulnerable tenants in the same, let's assume it's a multi-unit apartment building. Advancing the city's interest in what, making more apartments available for people who are looking for them?
It's an interest in maintaining affordable housing stock, because what you're doing...
How do we know it's affordable? I don't understand the intricacies of your rent control law, but my understanding is that once the landlord negotiates and the tenant departs, when the prospective tenant looks at the apartment, the landlord can quote a higher rental rate based on today's market values than the prior tenant was paying before he moved out. Is that right?
Yes, and that's exactly.
So how does that protect low-income housing for deserving people who can't afford to pay the higher rate?
Because it takes that unit, which is at a certain rent control rate, and now subjects it to a much higher market rate. So you had a tenant.
So this ordinance, as Judge Bay was suggesting, if two or more tenants have moved out, it lowers the value of the apartment so the landlord can't obtain even market rates for the apartment because the value has been.
I'm not sure if I understand your question. I think the way that when you do a buyout, it has an impact on the affordability of available housing, because that same unit is now going to be charged rent at the market rate, which is higher than the existing rent prior to the buyout.
It may take the whole property off the rental market, right? If
that's
the plan is to convert it to condos and sell them.
Or just to sell them.
Okay, that I understand, that there would actually be fewer spaces available. But what I'm having a hard time understanding is why this doesn't amount to some kind of a taking, because it produces a diminution in the value that the landlord can realize, both from future rents. Also, if you ever wanted to sell the building as an apartment building, as Judge Bay suggested, it operates as a cloud at the time.
that's the only reason the landlord wants to do it, let's suppose. Anytime a buyout happens, you're either increasing the rent that's going to be asked for that apartment, or you're taking it out of the rental market altogether. If you limit condominium conversions for 10 years, you're removing that incentive to do the buyout in the first place, and so that buyout will not occur, and so it will not have the effect of either subjecting it to market rents or taking it out of the rental market altogether. So that serves the city's interest in maintaining affordable rental
value. The ordinance is essentially to freeze the status quo, to permit people to continue living in apartment buildings at below market rates by removing any economic incentive or indeed a legal ability on the part of the landlord to do anything other than continue renting the apartment at whatever rate he's currently getting.
No, it does not remove the landlord's ability to do a buyout. It doesn't freeze anything, and it removes one economic incentive. There may be any number of economic reasons. It could be you want to charge market rent, it could be you want to sell the property, it could be you want to do a condominium conversion, and so on, or something else. But it takes one thing and puts a limit on the condominium lottery for 10 years. But that's not a freeze, that's not prohibiting the landlord from doing a buyout. It's not forcing the landlord to continue renting the property. The landlord can take it off the market.
I guess I don't understand what the economic incentive is now for the landlord in light of the existence of this ordinance. You've effectively severely limited the owner's ability to do anything with the property other than maintain the status quo.
I don't think that's true, and maybe I'm not understanding your concern. The landlord, it doesn't restrict the landlord's ability to sell the property. The landlord can do that. It doesn't restrict the landlord's...
Isn't the value of the property, as Judge Rader was suggesting in his questions, lessened because the property is subject to this ordinance? So if the owner wants to maximize his financial return by the sale of the property, it essentially dampens the sale value, the fair market value of the property, because of the ordinance's cloud on the value of the property. It limits the right of the purchaser of the property, who might be interested in buying it, from the purchaser's ability to do much with the property, other than continue to operate it at the status quo.
There is no right to participate in a condominium conversion lottery. The city doesn't have to allow condominium conversions at all. And the only question is whether it is doing it in an arbitrary way. And it's not doing it in an arbitrary way because for two reasons with respect to the categories of tenants. These are people who may have special hurdles in finding a place of housing.
I'm totally with you with regard to the disabled, the ill, and the seniors. I'm having a really difficult time assuming that that's true with regard to two or more conversions not involving what I'll call special tenants.
Two or more conversions have a greater impact on the availability of affordable rental housing than one.
Now we're back to the conundrum of once the unit is vacant, the landlord can charge a higher rent, market rent, to the next tenant that comes along. And that's not the class that this ordinance is supposed to be protecting.
That's true. There are some landlords who will decide to go ahead with a buyout, and then they will re-rent the unit at market rates. The question is not whether it discourages all buyouts, but if it reduces the number of buyouts, it reduces one incentive to engage in a buyout, and therefore reduces the number of buyouts, then it is rationally related to the city's legitimate interest in protecting. right to engage in a condominium conversion. That is, that's a zoning regulation that's in the city's police power.
Could you address the issue that I last discussed with Mr. Skinner, which is the publication of the price the landlord paid an invasion of privacy?
Yes. I think the case that they rely on, H&M Associates, it is really very different.
Yes, what?
It's a very different. The information at issue was very different. It was basically information about the landlord's financial status. It was an announcement to the world, this entity is insolvent. This entity is mismanaging this property. And so what the California Supreme Court held in Hill, which, by the way, was decided 14 years after H&M, the case that I'm talking about. The California Supreme Court said that the protected privacy interest is one where confidentiality is necessary to prevent unwarranted embarrassment and indignity. It did not say that every single piece of financial information is constitutionally protected. It has referred to financial information that discloses other information about the person, credit card statements, banking records. And I think when you're talking about financial status, the solvency of the corporation that was managing this property,
well, does the fact that the landlord paid a high price for a move out indicate that he's wealthy?
Not necessarily.
Well, it's circumstantial evidence of it.
I don't think that's correct, because...
And therefore, he may be a mark for the next tenant to ask for more money for
them. Landlords can often afford to pay a lot in buyouts because they can recapture so much of that value by re-renting the unit at market rent. Doesn't mean that they are simply wealthy. The reason that many of these buyouts are high is because the landlord is able to gain so much extra value either by selling the unit or re-renting it at market rates. We haven't discussed the commercial speech argument. Briefly, I think it's clear that the buyout negotiations are commercial speech. Judge Hamilton's opinion was very thorough on that issue, so this is more technical questions.
Thank you very much. Mr. Scannell, I'll give you a couple of minutes.
I want to address what was took up a fair amount of Mr. Goldman's time, which is this idea that somehow these tenants are being protected and affordability is being protected by this condominium conversion law. The simple fact is that to the extent we're talking about even ill or disabled tenants who are being who are parties to a buyout negotiation, what we're talking about are people who are being given all sorts of procedural protections to make sure that it's not coerced, that it's voluntary, who are being paid a lot of money to leave and who have made the decision that they're on their own, that it's a worthwhile thing for them. Nobody's forcing them out. And so we're not protecting those people by then 7, 8, 9 years down the line saying, oh, by the way, landlord, you engaged in this negotiation. Now you can't condominiumize. And so, you know, then that gets to the question of affordability. And quite frankly, by doing this and discouraging buyout negotiations, the only person you're making it affordable for is the existing tenant. You're certainly not increasing affordability for the future tenants because, as Your Honor pointed out, we can increase the rent. And so the current tenant is certainly more affordable for them under rent control, but they, again, have made the calculated decision that it's more valuable to them to take the buyout negotiation and leave than to stay.
If the 10-year suspension gives the tenant leverage to negotiate up the price of the buyout.
Well, I'm not sure how that would necessarily be the case. In fact, it might be exactly the opposite, which is now I, as a landlord, don't have the option of using my property. That way I'm willing to pay less because I have fewer options for what I can do with that property once I've left.
So you think that the 10-year moratorium
yes.
Is irrational?
I do, and I wanted, the last point I was going to make is, to the extent that the city is concerned about condominiumizing generally, taking rental units off the market, there's no rational purpose for singling out just this small subcategory of landlords and saying, everyone else, you can keep doing it, you can keep going in through the normal process, but you guys, because you negotiated with your tenants, you get stuck with a special rule that's more burdensome and a complete ban. There's no... It has no connection, this particular prohibition, on the broader public issue of whether condominiums, generally speaking, might or might not be an issue with affordability. And so, yes, we contend that it is an irrational penalty on these landlords for exercising their basic rights. I want to address also, if I have just another minute, because we didn't talk about it before, the issue of commercial speech. I think Baba and Larson both stand for the proposition that this is not a traditional commercial speech case. Larson specifically called out the fact that traditional commercial speech cases have all arisen in the context of sort of a faceless vendor and a customer, and you have your economic interaction and then you're done. That's not what's going on here. You're talking about people, especially in San Francisco, who are essentially wedded for 30 years in some cases. You know, this is a very, very personal, complex relationship that is not like a traditional commercial interaction. And that's exactly what Bob said. That's exactly what Larson said, that this is a unique circumstance. And so, you know, the city obviously is workshopping a little bit here to avoid Bob and Larson. But those courts have recognized that the traditional commercial speech framework really doesn't fit here when you're talking about people who may even live in the same building as you and whom you have to deal with over the course of many years under compulsion of law.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
The case is argued and submitted, and we're adjourned for the day.